Ladies and gentlemen, it took a while, but we're finally here. Empire is here. That's kind of the one problem that we had, but the game finally starts. This is game number one in the Best of Three series between these two teams, Empire and Fantastic Five in the Dota 2 Champions League. We are in Group A. This is a lower bracket match. And what that means is that the loser of this one will actually drop out, which is unfortunate if you're Fantastic Five. If they end up losing here, that'll be their only game in this particular season of the D2CL, as they were replacing new team 123 in this particular group. So don't be too surprised, for example, if you check the coverage page on joinDOTA and suddenly see five teams in that one group. That is all correct. Empire, though, they dropped to No Logic Gaming here in the first match of this group, and yeah, they are also facing elimination here if they don't win this best of three series, and that would be a shame since they are actually the defending champions of Season 5, the one that's about 5 months ago. And also Season 3 here, if you want to go that far back. But yeah, we'll see how they can perform today. And yeah, to help me break down this game, to help me see what they have, I have my wonderful co-caster, SB Revolution 5, also known as Revo. How are you doing, man?
I'm doing great. I'm really excited for this game. Team Empire always puts on a good show, and Fantastic Five, I mean, hopefully they won't live up to the name of the recent Fantastic Four movie, which was terrible, but they've got some very good names on them. I mean, BZZ, Sedoy, Yol, players that I believe in the past have played for, I want to say Yol played for Empire at one point.
But yeah, Empire VP.
Well, that's CIS players.
Yeah, absolutely, and they've yet to prove themselves in that configuration, and not too many games. Three, in fact, are recorded. Two wins against pretty unknown teams, and then the loss to No Logic Gaming as well. In, I believe, what was that? In Frankfurt Major Euro qualifiers, actually. So, there you go. They still have yet to prove themselves. Of course, a win against Empire here would definitely do that. But let's actually take a look at the draft before it passes by too quickly. Darkseer and Nightstalker banned for Empire, as well as the Wisp and the Doom for Fantastic Five. So, not much to say there. And then the Beastmaster actually picked up first, along with the Lich. So, what do you think about that?
I really like Lich in an offlane support position. He does so much this patch. It used to be you don't get the early point in Ice Armor, but you put Beastmaster up against someone with Ice Armor on him, it's just ridiculous. You can put any hero in the offlane, to be honest here. I played it last night with a Lich Omni dual lane where I was playing Omni farming and got Orb of Venom, Degen Aura, and then Lich's Frost Armor. And as soon as someone attacked me, I just jumped on them, and they were slowed as could be. So it gives you that kind of early aggression that you want to get out of that Beastmaster pick. Not to say the Beastmaster is for sure offlane, because he could be mid, he could even be safe lane. We've seen him all over the place in this meta, especially with Team Monkey Business, I believe, have brought him up.
Yeah, I do believe, though, that this will be the offlane, especially with the Lich, and that's why we see, I mean, the rise of the offlanes, or the offlane dual lanes, has been one of the stories of this particular meta, of this particular patch, 6.85, and the Lich is a big part of that, especially since the change that you can now sacrifice without giving over XP, so you can stay in the lane, you're more of an active role with the armor as well as the frost blast, just so harass, and that's just such a big augmentation to these kind of strength melee heroes, which is also kind of pretty much the meta here. So that's why we saw the Lich Doom offlane be super successful and super hard to deal with, and one of the reasons we actually see Doom picked and banned so often. But yeah, maybe the Beastmaster can fill a similar role to that, of course, a little bit of a different niche on him. And yeah, more strength melee, Slaughter picked up for Empire, and Fantastic Five, they already picked up the Tusk and the Queen of Pain in first phase, so pretty standard, very strong heroes these days. A lot of positioning, a lot of mobility on these heroes. And then the Alchemist. So that kind of throws you through, or can throw a little bit of a loop. We've seen mid Alchemists be very prevalent, just so you have the rune control as well. But there can always be a safe lane Queen of Pain if they want to run it like that. Or just flip the script, run a safe lane Alchemist, farm the hell out of him, and then decide what you want to do, how many axe scepter upgrades you want to give out.
Yeah, and I really like the Winter Wyvern. There's already the Beastmaster that gives you that lockdown up against the Alchemist. If your whole team is jumping on Alchemist and you get Winter's Cursed, it's going to get pretty ugly, because with all these strength melee heroes, they hit hard, they want to stand close together. That's not what you want to do against Winter Wyvern. However, I will say the Slaughter against Alchemist, one of Alchemist's biggest weaknesses is his low armor and his reliance on his regen. If Slaughter gets amp damage off on him and you follow up with pretty much any physical damage, which now they'll have even more armor reduction, they've already got the physical damage from Beastmaster's axes, it's starting to look pretty ugly for an Alchemist game here. I'd rather play against an AA than this, because at least with AA, if he misses the ult, well, he misses the ult. With Slaughter, if he accidentally misclicks the ult, he's got 5 seconds and he can do it again.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a huge amount of minus armor, and plus armor as well, coming out from Lich alone for Team Empire here. Minus 20, I believe, is level 3 of the Amplified Damage, and then the minus 8 from the Aura, or minus 6, from the Shadow Friend. That is quite a bit, and yeah, as you said, one of the big weaknesses of the Alchemist, so he will probably want to consider an earlier armor item. Even the Solo Crest can also already work up against it, and later on, the Sword Cuirass. But it's definitely something that you can deal with if you don't get rumbled by it, right? You have to... If they keep picking up the Alchemist, where it doesn't get to a point where it can actually be ahead enough, because that's what Alchemists need to do, right? I mean, he's a hero that can get ahead very fast, but at the same time, a hero that needs to be. Right? If you just stick him off on a 1v1 fight against most carries here with like 10k gold, then he's more often than not gonna draw the shorter end of the stick in that regard. But they do have a good supporting cast here to just save him and keep him alive, even if he does get jumped on here with the Winter Wyvern and Tusk already.
Yeah, and we see Bane and Witch Doctor banned out, but Fantastic Five are actually going to go for the Undying. So, is this a support Undying, you think, in an offlane Tusk, or the other way around?
Might still see some dual lanes coming out here with the Winter Wyvern helping out the safe lane, whoever that may be. Maybe even an aggro try with Tusk, Winter Wyvern, Undying.
I'd actually like to see Tusk, Winter Wyvern in an aggro lane, and then Queen of Pain, Undying, so that you don't end up with a double melee lane anywhere.
Yep.
The Lina is very nice, though. With Lina and Shatterfiend, you've got pretty decent attack speed, Beastmaster as well, and that's going to help you tear down the Tombstone in a teamfight, which is going to be very important. Also, Lina has enough burst to kill off Alchemist, and that is an enormous factor. Just because, okay, Laguna Blade to the face, follow up with a nuke, Alchemist is low, and he can't regen in time to survive a few right clicks. Not to mention the, of course, armor reduction factor. It's a scary lineup for Empire, and Fantastic Five, well, they're going to have to stand up against it somehow.
Well, they can definitely here with these, with the heals that they have, with the counter-engagement potential from someone like a Tusk and some bursts of their own, mostly from the Queen of Pain. But yeah, if I look at Empire's lineup, I'll just see lots of minus armor, quite a bit of burst here, solid supports on both lanes, and solid lockdown as well, just from Beastmaster Ultimate, as well as the Slaughter, Blink Crush, and the Crush is on a very low cooldown as well, only 8 seconds on all levels, so it's... I don't know, it seems much, much scarier than Fantastic Five's lineup is, but yeah, of course, we'll see how that turns out at the end of it all. But for now, if you're just tuning in, welcome again, my name is DragonDrop, I'm joined by Revo here for the Dota 2 Champions League Season 6, a best of 3 between the Fantastic Five and Team Empire. The winner of this match will move on to fight. Will they actually fight the loser of Liquid? No Logic Gaming, actually. Liquid versus and No Logic Gaming already played. Liquid won that. So No Logic Gaming will be the next opponent. They will battle
waiting
each other.
Waiting for Empire. Hopefully getting their revenge. Yeah.
Or Fantastic Five, yeah. We are unbiased
here.
Well,
yeah, possibly.
But yeah, the point is, this is a loser's bracket match, so if you lose here, you're out. And it's a best of three, contrary to what Dota 2 Lounge thinks, so it's not a two-game series. Alright, yeah, let's quickly introduce our teams here, as it doesn't look like we're going to have any action starting with these here. The Fantastic Five, we've got BZZ on the Alchemist, Yol playing the Undying. Up here we have Sadoi on the Queen of Pain, actually making his way to the offlane here with that huge amount of regen. King R playing the support Winter Wyvern. And that leaves the safe lane for Ghostig on that task all alone.
Yeah, it looks like I was right on the lanes. I just didn't think they'd be in the lanes that they're in. But Resolution going to be off lane on the Beastmaster. We'll have no fear here playing the Lich to support him. Mid lane, it looks like Yoki is going to be taking up the Shadow Fiend here. Aloha Dance going to be here on the Lina. And up top, it's last but not least going to be Silent on the Slaughter.
Definitely didn't expect the Queen of Pain to be up here, but at the same time, kind of kicking myself for not doing so, because It's a hero that can't work in every single lane, usually in a solo position though, so that's what makes it a little bit different. But of course, with your ult here as well, you do have that team fighter that can really benefit. That can really benefit from the Queen of Pain in the long run.
Yeah.
Same time.
And you can see the potential here, like undying, decaying, taking away strength, and then following that up with a nuke. You just do so much damage in the lane. Like Slaughter has 350 max HP at the moment.
Three stacks on him, and then every single bit of damage that you do to him, it just feels like so much more.
Yep.
Then when you get the strength back, it's all percentage based, so you actually do take more damage in that respect, I think. Same time, we have the Empire dual lane here, as expected, with Beastmaster plus Lich, and they should be doing fairly well. They're up against a melee Tusk, who, well, can kind of run these kind of situations where it doesn't get too much. He just has to be careful not to die, and it might be an issue. He's only level 1, has opted for the ice shards first, doesn't have the snowball available, and even then, it's not really the most reliable escape, since more often than not, you're forced to roll towards your opponent.
Yeah, unless that bird gets in a bad position, he's going to be struggling to find a way out with the snowball right now. Now, in the mid lane, Alchemist versus Shadow Fiend. I keep going back and forth on this matchup. It looks like BZZ is playing it out a bit better right now, but as Yoki gets more damage, and eventually when he gets the 1 point up in the armor reduction, it's going to be a bit rough for him to sustain against Shadow Fiend, simply because Alk's got 2 armor right now. He does have a stout shield, but his agility gain is so poor that 2 armor is going to be like that for quite a while. And Shadow Fiend can really just outrange him and right-click him down, finish him off with some raises, yeah.
Can he, though? I mean, look at this AoE from the Acid Spray, and that's what's really hurting him right now. Yoku can't really stand out of that and can't evenly trade here, not with only 4 levels, only 2 levels up into raises. And whenever he walks up, he's going to take some damage. And then, BZZ, he's going to be close to level 6 as well, so even then, with a bottle now to tide him over, he's gonna have plenty of region to play with, where that burst doesn't really matter too much. And yeah, once again, Yoku, he's getting some last hits now, but he's still trailing a little bit behind, which is not really the case against most melee mid laners up against ranged ones, but the Alchemist is in a very unique position in this regard.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised Aloha Dance isn't rotating to stack some camps for him, seeing as he is getting behind in the mid lane, but there's still time for him to stack, of course. Until those raises are maxed, you can't really farm camps that well.
Oh, top lane, they're gonna go on Yul. The silent misses the stun, though. That'll be that, and double.
And that's another double.
Double decay comes out. Yeah, look at these stacks. He's 5 of those.
Six of those.
Can't even count so many, are they? They have to walk out anyway. But yeah, Sonoy, he has plenty of regen. Undying also has us off. But they should be fine. And yeah, these dual lanes as well, it's a little bit of a problem here, because a dual lane puts on more pressure than a solo lane most of the time. I know, basic math, but it means that, especially since you're already running a dual lane yourself on Team Empire, which was telegraphed as well by the Lich pick, you are only left with one support supporting the safe lane, and Slaughter is a hero that can get caught out. It is quite tanky at level 1, but with the sprints, not so much. If he tries to get out, it's kind of, alright, if you then catch him then, he's in a little bit of trouble. So Low Dance has to stay here. You can't really do too much to stack up camps, and same time, they don't want to give their advantage up down here in the bottom, rotating no fear out.
Now, I do want to mention BZZ has gotten the supports to rotate and secure him a double damage rune up top, went ahead and popped that, and then walked all the way to bot to get the bounty rune. Most heroes, this would be devastating, because you're leaving lane for so long, you're not getting farm, but for Alchemist, that's 500 gold, practically, so who cares?
He shot up to 600 GPM for a second there, and I kind of forgot to check the GPM when you first pick up the room, because it's actually like 2,000, which is not significant at all, but I find it hilarious nonetheless.
Yeah.
Level 6 for both these heroes, so BZZ.
3 seconds in, he has 2,000 gold per minute. Record-breaking.
Oh, yeah.
Such balance.
Yeah, balance here indeed. But yeah, so far not much happening. First blood still has to happen. No one really wants to go for it. Who do you expect to go aggressive first here?
Well, I mean, it doesn't have to happen.
Yes.
But it probably will. No, the game could go with no kills. It's possible, Dragon Drop.
Revo, when have you played Dota last? You ever seen a team game with no kills?
I mean, I've never seen one, but theoretically.
Oh, man.
But I do think the Empire have the better aggression. They have much more...
Oh, hello. Might have checked some resolution. You're caught with the Ice Blast, but they turn it around with few nukes onto Ghostig, and now the tango was the mango was eaten with a snowball out Ghostig very slow. But thanks to the ball and another nuke will finish him off, so yeah. Didn't jinx them after all. It looks like they want to go for more. Double ball slow here onto King R. Resolution, he goes in deep, and he will get the secondary kill. Yol comes back with the tombstone to try and make this a trade, but he's also being slowed up by these boars, and yeah. It's not going. Oh, wow, this is going to be enough. Wow, the DK plus the soul rip.
Yeah.
Didn't quite expect that.
He could have gotten him with soul rip, I think, with the zombies nearby, but he didn't risk it, which was probably smart. Especially since it is only level 1.
Thing is, Beastmaster also had some stick charges left. It might have been enough to actually save him from that. Man.
Yeah.
Of course, the Caster's Curse just want to say, hey, not much is happening.
I don't know. They might get aggressive and... Yeah, Fantastic Five got aggressive real quick, but definitely paid for it. Even though Undying was able to get that kill, they will leave him bot for now, Ghostick rotating up a bit, and probably switching into a bit more of a supportive role, simply because he has gotten almost no farm this entire game.
Yep.
He will block the stack, though, so that's nice. Well,
really, though?
Wait, what?
He's a little bit fearful, but that means that there is a triple stack for Yoku to farm up now. He has max level raises, so that shouldn't be a problem. It's always the...
Oh, if he times it right... Throw the shard!
Yeah, I think he got the
troll. Felt like he could have got a little more out of that, but it is something. And Queen of Pain rotating up now. They could get Yoki here.
Well, they could, but no fears here. Yes, his ultimate! The bounces once, the Sidoriu blinks out, and the snowball comes through too. But now more help is here from the Lina. There's a Sonic Wave, but both heroes just fall! Make that three heroes, I don't know. Undying, didn't know when he got here, but it wasn't a good idea.
They almost had him, but that Lich ult and the fact that Tusk was unable to dodge it with the snowball quickly enough meant that they really had a lot of slow going their way, and they couldn't get a few extra right hooks off, and that really made
up
difference.
King R. But the Cold Embrace will keep it safe for now. Now Silence is in trouble, the Ice Shards block him in. No fear, out of mana to actually do anything to try and help. And now he has another crash that might be enough to get him out to safety. But there's Snowball, still in range. Is it fast enough? That's on level 1 spin, but should be enough. Maybe not with the Ice Shards, not quite enough to actually finish him off. And Silent will survive, courtesy of the Power Treads.
Yeah, and meanwhile down in the bot lane, Resolution is going for the tower. He's only 500 gold from a level 1 Necro Book. And this is the fruits of his labors to help him get that first blood. He'll go ahead and roar down Yol, and I believe he'll stay.
He pops a tombstone, the tower's aggroing onto Resolution, and the heal will come out. So not quite enough burst damage, and actually also roar down. Only about 80 second cooldown, it's not the worst, but still.
Yeah, you kind of had to use that roar there, otherwise he was going to drop tombstone initially, and you'd really struggle to get out from under the tower. So going ahead and using that roar gave you a second to move before he dropped the tombstone, and then less zombies can spawn on you during that time. So it was a good move, all in all, but it didn't result in the kill, obviously, as Ghostick is getting run down now. They're going to go after Yold now that they know the tombstone's down.
Yeah, that shook in his kill here. They clear through the creeps, they get the slow off from the frost blast, and Lina's there, low dance, she snags the kill away. And we haven't talked about the Lina too much as our support position. How much do you like it compared to the core now in 6.85?
I think it's perfectly fine. It's a support who can actually get some farm, especially if the carry leaves the lane, simply because once you've matched Dragon Slave, up until about 22 minutes, I want to say it is, you can use that to one-hit the ranged creep. And of course, it does a lot of damage to the melee creeps that you can then just finish off with right clicks or your stun if you really want to. So it does give you potential to transition. And we've still seen players like Solo do very well on the hero and even get, I want to say, like 15-minute Aghanim Scepters.
Yep, alright.
Or something.
Might see engagement in mid here. Empire was smoked up, but couldn't quite find the opening. BZ knew that something was happening here. Walked towards his teammates up near the top rune spot. It was just a play to secure the rune. Maybe they don't actually know what's happening here. But there we go. They're coming in. Resolution comes in. It's BZ doesn't have his ultimate off, so they will have an easy time bursting him down. Now the frost blast comes in.
Chain frost.
Oh no, King Arch trying to teleport out of the razors. Just enough. And now two more heroes down, a tier 1 in trouble. No one really in position to try and fight this, of course, with two heroes down. One of them being your alchemist, you don't really want to. He's going for the Radiance build, by the way, haven't talked about that yet.
Goldie has a relic.
He does have 10 minutes, which is kind of becoming the standard timing for professional mid alchemist if you get enough bounty runes.
Resolution. Teleport in from Sidoi, gets the burst down, and now Empire on the run. Doesn't look like Fantastic Five can get more though, but yeah, decent rotation. Don't get it tally nigh though, and yeah, Shadow Fiend still survives. He's on top of the net worth chart, exactly where he wants to be.
If they'd had a tombstone up for that, it would have been very useful. But this is one thing to point out about Alchemist. So Alchemist is sitting at 1,000 net worth less than the Shadow Fiend. And sure, Shadow Fiend's got 3 kills, but Alchemist has been farming incredibly well. And you really want to, if you have an Alchemist, you want to be the best farmer on the map by far. You get free gold for creeps, you should be killing creeps faster than anyone. But Shadow Fiend can kill them a little more efficiently than you, honestly, without much items.
Yeah, he can, but the trouble with Alchemist is, of course, he gets so much more for each single last hit. I mean, he has about half the last hits of the Shadow Fiend. Oh god, missed the kill there. Sidoi gets picked off down here in the bottom lane. Oh, it's just...
I didn't see that one either, honestly.
Yeah, I think he blinked out, just blinking away from Alodin and Sanofi, and then Yoku was there just at the right time, at the right place. Kind of just herded him in, I guess. Yeah, Empire looking good.
About 500 to go on Alk's Radiance, and Beastmaster has finished up that level 1 Necrobook. So these tier 1 towers were very easy for them to take down, and it's going to get even easier, even though they're going to just go for Roche right now. They were spotted by a ward, but I don't think they really care since they'll take it down so quickly. With the armor reduction coming out, Roche is going to be at negative 10 armor, and it's done.
This is so, so fast with the start on their team, and even the Fantastic Five were in a position to fight, they really aren't, because Winter Wyvern, that's the one big teamfight ultimate control, I want to say, still doesn't have his level 6. The Winter's Curse is not on the table yet. What is on the table, though, is that Radiant's now completed. About 12 and a half minutes in on that Alchemist, so that's going to be their play for Fantastic Five. Just make sure that the Alchemist farms up ridiculously, but does get his ultimate off this time. Is it going to be enough with all the bursts? Doesn't look like it. Resolution and no fear. That offlane duo get a free pick off here in the dire side jungle, and the rest of Fantastic Five, they have to walk away. But Silent finds Gosek here teleporting out. It's a very long time, it looked like he still has snowballs, still has the shards to try and delay this a little bit, but it's not going to work. At the same time, Winter Wyvern just dies back here, and on the line, Yol.
And Yol.
Yoku is just going ham here in the back lines. He doesn't even give a damn.
Okay, I'm gonna keep an eye on Sedoi just in case they somehow pick him off from all the way across the map, because it's about what it feels like here. They just have enough bursts to really do a lot. And another thing is, Empire have a great mix of physical and magical damage. Like, Shadow Fiend is already a great hero in that respect, but Lina and Lich adding a lot of magical, Beastmaster and Slaughter adding a lot of physical. You can't just say, oh, well, we pick up a casual plate mail and suddenly we're invincible against this team. We pick up a cloak and suddenly we're invincible. No, you have to commit a lot of itemization to get strong defensively against this team, and even then, it's only going to go so far.
And this is such a cruel timing here for Empire. Fantastic Five are no way ready to fight with that Alchemist. Alchemist going for a Radiance build, which is kind of slow when it comes to fighting. And then not even having the level 6 on the Winter Wyvern, not finding a single extra point of experience here. Losing 2 towers in the offlane for... and a lost teamfight as well.
Yeah, I really like the Solar Crest build on Alk better because you can actually go with your team and do something. Because, to be honest, you don't need to sit and farm for hours. You're not going to out-carry most hard carries in the game with it. So if you're going for this Radiance, you're saying, I can go to the jungle and farm, and that's great. But this game does not matter if you have 10,000 gold per minute when your Ancient dies. If your Ancient dies, you lose.
Yeah, that's how Dota works. Glad you find the card on, Revo. Kappa. But yeah, it is true. I mean, right now, it's 50 minutes in, Empire is sitting at a 10,000 gold lead.
Wow.
Didn't realize it was that bad. And that's up against an Alchemist, mind you. 10,000 experience also. Empire, at this rate, they're going to push the high ground by 20 minutes. I mean, they're getting the Mac on the Lich. They just completed that now. They're going to have the level 3 Necrobook on the way on Akura right now as well. Shadow Fiend, he has a double damage rune bottle. He has an Aegis, a Blink, and a Sanji Nasha. I mean, what's stopped them right now?
Missed chance on Radiance if you get really lucky. I'm not trying to flame Alk, because he is actually one of my favorite heroes. It's just this playstyle is not working very well. And me, oh god.
When did they rotate up here? Holy shit. That was quick. They get two more, and that leaves Yoku alone down here in the jungle. Don't know that it really matters for him. He's looking for a pick off here, maybe with a Requiem.
Yeah, I'm trying to keep an eye on chat for the T-Tours, but you gotta realize, like, when these kills happen in the blink of an eye, moving the camera over there in time is actually an Olympic sport.
It is indeed.
We should get medals.
Well, maybe time to switch to the fully automated directed broadcaster from Valve.
Oh yeah.
Didn't Toby say once in like free to play or somewhere that they wanted them to use that at TI1? It was like, no way, man, no way.
Yeah. Aren't there still people that want Toby to use that?
Shots fired.
I
think yeah.
They definitely want me to use it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we need the Pimp Muckle brand broadcast AI.
Oh yeah, just machine learning. Just put Pimp on a machine for like
the
Pimp 2 weeks straight.
Singularity.
Just do some machine learning. Put Pimp 2 weeks on the controls. Then Yoku is going so aggro here. So that's a foregone conclusion that this tier 2 is going to fall now. 70 minutes in, and nothing really stopping them from taking the other tier 2 as well after this.
There's nothing stopping them.
Yeah. The only thing that they have right now, Fantastic Five, for high ground defense, is that one score is finally up and running, and that might be enough if you get it on the right target.
They've had this Aegis, and they've only been in danger of losing it once. And if I'm not mistaken, I believe that the last time Fantastic Five got a kill was around 10 minutes.
That's
7 minutes of nothing. Well, I mean, your Alchemist is farming, but...
About 10
and
minutes,
then he goes for Boots of Travel. Oh. See, here's the problem. You're playing very passively, and if you were ahead, that's fine. Okay, getting these Boots of Travel is going to enable you to split push, rat out the game, and extend the game to get you fatter and stay ahead. But you're very far behind. You can't afford to play this passively and expect to get away with it. It's too greedy.
Yep. As an alchemist, you need the cooperation of your team. You need not only yourself to be ahead, you also need the rest of your team to at least keep up, and there's only so much that you can give them with an Aghanim Scepter, especially in this game. I mean, Tusk is kind of meh. Queen of Pain, it is useful, of course. Winter Wyvern doesn't have an Axe Upgrader, if I'm not mistaken.
No, I did speak a little too soon. It looks like Alk has picked up Yasha, so that's going to be good indeed. But
still, still just another farming item, right?
Yeah, unless he goes for Sanjin Yasha, it's another farming item. And even if he does go Sanjin Yasha, you could have Sanjin Yasha at 10 minutes on this hero. Like, do you understand what that means? You can literally go fight someone, anyone, at 10 minutes into the game. But you want to farm?
Well.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. Can work in games, but none of this one when Empire is just knocking at your door 20 minutes into the game. And that's what will happen. They might wait for the next Roche. Or some extra items here, maybe the BKB on Slaughter, who of course already completed Link, Lure Dance, working on Aghanim Scepter. Less than 1,000 gold away from it, mind you, from a support leaner position 20 minutes in, so...
Yep.
Yeah. They're just gonna go straight up high ground here. Fantastic Five, they have to back and they have to hope for a good defense here.
But what is Alk gonna do? Like, you throw a stun, and then you hope you survive long enough to do some damage with your Radiance.
Yep.
But they're just playing it safe. They're going to back up. They'll get a amp damage out on the Alk. I'm surprised they didn't kind of stick around and try to get a few more heroes amped, but...
No reason to do that. As I said, you can get your extra items here. Beastmaster now with Necrophobia finish. Goes for Blink of Zone, but probably also consider Boots of Travel at some point or another. So mass mobility here inside of Empire as well.
And Lich. Beastmaster has got so much right now.
Yeah.
Like, he is sitting... 2k gold ahead of the Queen of Pain, who had a pretty great laning stage in my opinion, but it just hasn't worked out since then. And
catch out Yol here, they go up north. He knows what's happening right now, as you see Silent caught up in Creeper, but can he get out? Doesn't have a TP cooldown. Resolution has the means to scout him, and yeah, drops on Tombstone, tries to make them work for it, but this should be a pickoff sooner or later. Yeah. Amp damage for good measure, and an extra 125 from the tombstone. Not 150 actually at level 4, so not what you want to have happen. Sidori is farming, he doesn't have his Orchid yet, though.
Yeah, and I really feel like Undying just shouldn't have been there. You can't go out that far on the map right now, unless you're maybe the Alchemist, but even then, you have 1,000 HP. What is he going? No, don't do it out. Don't go for the Manta.
It's not sure you can do too much, right? I mean, sure, you can sort of try and push out the waves, but these illusions, they're not tanky at all. Those aren't like 60-minute Nagasaren illusions.
I mean, I know I'm harping on this Alk a lot, but you're committing 3 item slots to getting more items. And sure,
smoke now, it will break. There's a snowball here to Resolution. It might be able to pick him off with the Winter's Curse as well. And they do, but the Chain Frost is coming in. Yoku pops the BKB, and that's Ghostly going down first. Silent blinks after, looking for more. Get the amp damage off on King R. Pops the Cold Embrace, and that'll only keep him in place to finally secure his fate. And that'll be 2-for-1 trade. Pretty good one, all things considered, for Fantastic Five, right?
It's like, you get 2-for-1, can I see a fright recap? Yeah, you still get 200 more gold right now for that one fight. And 200 more XP as well. So it's worth it, and especially when you're losing heroes that aren't as important. Like, sure, Tusk is a core, but this Tusk has nothing. Yep. So I'm not considering him a core.
The bigger problem for me is that they use 2 big ultimates to make that happen. One's the Queen of Pain, who has not been pulled an Iron Scepter or built one herself yet. And 2, the Winter's Curse, and those are ultimates that you have to fight with. And if Empire would have wanted, if they would have maybe already had the Aegis, then they could have had a much easier time going high ground, even without Resolution there. Well, Lower Dance finds himself in the soon, spots out PZC. Yeah, they might actually go for him now, if they find him again.
Yeah.
Looks like they're just gonna play it safe again. They're having a sigil over. That's a Fantastic Five sigil, of course. It will expire. Roshan has not respawned yet, but it will in a moment's time.
Patience, Yoki. Patience. It'll be rewarded. No, don't. You're gonna have to walk back in a second.
Be fine. They have the courier here, flying by, just casually delivering the BKB.
And the Aloha Dance ward, too.
Yeah.
It's a bit Lina shaped, but it works. And here we go. Rosh starts at 23:15.
Yeah,
I'm saying 15 seconds.
They only now get the amplified damage on though, so it's like, but yeah, 15 seconds on right on the money right there. It's actually 14, 13 and a half really, but still. Immediate smoke
and
up here
into the. I'd like to clarify my comment about the Alk as well. I'm not saying that this build is absolutely terrible in every situation.
No.
I'm saying that in this situation, it doesn't work.
Yep. Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's a perfectly good build if the rest of your team can actually hold on to the space on the map. But in this game, it just hasn't happened. I mean, look at the net worth Alchemist. Yeah, he's made this farming build work. It's not exactly what it's supposed to do. He's on top of the net worth chart by a country mile, but the rest of his team isn't. Link crash onto King R. He doesn't get anything off of the extra bash, so that'll be one hero down for the count right straight off the bat. Sidori still has his ultimate. Winter Wyvern also has his, and just can't use it if you're dead, obviously. No buyback on him. You could have took quite a bit of damage here. Oh, wow, that's a roar. That's a roar on Sidori? Okay. Not sure what he's doing all alone up there, but it's not to the benefit of Fantastic Five, but in a lot of trouble right now. That should be a set of racks at least, unless they can pull out some sort of miracle. Winter Wyvern will be back, so a little bit of a source of problems for Empire. Also, this acid spray proved to be very annoying.
Yeah.
Still holding on, only a little bit more damage down to the tier 3.
I mean, they're just poking away at it because they know they've got the late game right now. Unless Alk pulls a Lota and just gets crazy farmed in the span of 3 minutes and completely turns this game around, which it would be quite the comeback. I'll say that much. But
the thing they've got going for them is that not all lanes are being pushed in. Empire just focusing on the single lane, which is not exactly ideal, since they could have easily rotated someone up here to the middle lane and kept that pressure up as well. Just to spread out the defensive lines for the Fantastic Five a little bit more.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fantastic Five, I'm sure they're not really feeling fantastic right now. It's been a rough game.
Gonna go for Desperation Smoke play here. It will pop as the lower dance gets it from the low ground. That should be a dead leaner here with the Orca coming out as well. Not a whole lot that he can do. But there's help on the way, maybe? No, okay. Don't want to go for it.
That's 1,000 gold for Coin of Pain now in the bank, so... They will get another Bounty Rune up on Alk, and it's going to be the Soul Booster coming out of him right now. So, Octarine.
Yep. It's a pretty good build, and at this point, you do start to get a little bit tankier.
You yeah. can make it. I mean, and at this point, your one option is Split Push.
Yeah.
Your team fights are not going to work here, so yeah. I will give him that.
And for that, this build is perfect as well, because you can teleport or walk somewhere, pop the illusions, teleport to another lane, and problem is... Yeah. To actually make that work, you need vision. All they really have is this one observer ward up on the top rune spot, which isn't really giving you a whole lot this at this time in the game.
When Alk does get this Radiance Octarine, he can move his illusions around the map and then kind of create vision. It's not perfect, but it does give them a little more map control in this situation. So just playing Devil's Advocate here.
As you said, it's not ideal, especially if you compare it to what Empire have for vision. I mean, they don't have too many wards, but they have plenty here. There's one down on the bottom lane, and they also have this Hawk from the Beastmaster, and they also have BZZ potentially here. He has his ultimate going, gets the sun out to resolution, but there's so much more Empire than there is Fantastic Five, and no teleport cooldown even if he wants to. Sun was there. And he's only going to delay the inevitable at this point.
Yeah, tried to throw the stun just to do something before he died, but I don't think Empire really worry about that at all.
That's what I was talking about. If you're going to go for these kind of plays, you need vision. You need to know what's behind you. And in this case, it is Yoku who just caught the tail end of that. And it was a solo kill on a Queen of Pain.
Yeah, Scotty was doing just so much work. She was actually mid-animation for the blink away. But now he'll just blink up and take out King R if he can.
Pops the BKB, gets the raises off, gets punched up into the air, but should still be able to just right clicks him down. Oh man.
And still has the Aegis, gets the courier!
Gets the courier, still has the Aegis. He can pop up the ultimate here on the top if he wants to. Not with stuns coming out. Yeah, at the same time, hashtag space created. They're using so much time to bring him down that the rest of his team is banging away at a tier 3. And yeah, Yoku. The only thing that he did wrong was not having his BKB here, but still gets his ultimate off here. Still fighting. Gets punched up, trying to control the map as much as they can, but now they're fresh out of control, so he can start right-clicking. Not easy with the sigil, though, so it's... Oh, wow, he's out of reach, and you're right. And that's one boss race to finish him off. And a fleeting little bit of Romeo and Juliet here, both dying at the same time. So that's a... Yeah, 2-3-for-1 trade. If you just consider the... Yeah, if you just consider Shadow Fiend, but at the same time... Top melee Rax plus tower also went down. They're gonna try to make something, get something else out of that. It's gonna be no fear, but Resolution comes back in with a roar. They do get Sonoy again, Ghostsick as well. It's a 5-man wipe all over the map. The range Rax will fall immediately, buyback from Sonoy, but yeah, he has his ult, but what's he really going to do with it? It's level 2 ult at this point in the game where Empire just seems like they arrived in the late game, in the very late game for their lineup.
I assumed it was level 3 at that point, thinking, oh, he's going to get a beautiful ult, he's going to turn the game around. No, not with level 2. It's not enough.
That's 380 pure damage, that is absolutely nothing.
Yeah, and especially not without Ags, so...
Yeah.
It's a bit iffy.
I'm going to try again, I have nothing to stop a lower dance, so...
Yeah, Winter Wyvern TPing in, but without the ult, there's no stun. And that's another issue with this lineup. They've got a few stuns, but... It's Tusk's ult, which is relatively low cooldown, at least we can give him that. Wyvern's ult, which is not. And then Alk's stun, which is hard to get off properly. Let's just be completely honest here. And if it's not maxed, it doesn't do outstanding damage as well. So, and now there's a Lotus Orb. So even if you do get the stun off.
Yeah. Even the Sanji Niasha on the Beastmaster of all people. And it just says that, all right, Empire, we don't care. We just buy whatever items he wants to win the game now, and that's exactly that. Normally you don't really see that kind of an item here, especially 30 minutes in on the Beastmaster, but yeah, they have everything they need. No Fear has this has Glimmer Cape plus the Mechanism, Beastmaster has a Blink, even the Vlad's plus the Necrobook.
And a Blink Dagger on Lich.
Yeah, Blink Dagger on Lich. Blink Dagger on Lich as well, all have Blinks.
Just in case.
On Empire. They all have blinks once No Fear gets his delivered.
This is like 6.83 stopped you from blinking away afterwards.
Yeah.
Where core on everyone was blink. Blink AM, blink quap.
So it's like completeness. What does FF have? They have a ghost stepped on y'all.
Yeah, but again,
PZZ is loud. King R, pretty. They're gonna go or PZZ. No buyback on him either. The tombstone is gonna fall pretty much immediately. King R, next one on the list. I don't even want to hype this fight up because there's really not a lot to hype. And yeah, GG is called. Just a dominating performance here from Team Empire in this game, number one.
And they really handled the Alchemist well. They built a lineup that could really shut him down in the mid game right as soon as he gets that Radiance. Because, I mean, you shut him down in the early game, he says, well, okay, well, I'm not farming, I'm going to get a fighting build. And then you actually have a harder time shutting him down. So you let him farm a little bit, you shut him down later, and then there's nothing he can do.
Yep. All right.
Nothing.
Yep. But remember, guys, this is a best of three, so the Fantastic Five still have a chance to redeem themselves in that next game. Empire, though, looking in a really, really good place to make sure that their run in the Dota 2 Champions League is not over just yet. So, yeah, don't go too far away. We'll be right back.